Good morning, everyone, and happy Friday. So we have a lot to talk about today. The market itself isn't doing too much, but we do have some stocks that are moving in a pretty big way. I would say the top one would be Blink from yesterday. They are popping up pretty strongly on their earnings report, and they're actually holding their ground really well. They already had a pullback to like $37 this morning, so that's good to see. And Tom, they're actually running up with a good amount of momentum. And on top of that, we know how these EV stocks are. You know, when they get running, like they normally rise up in an exponential way.
Yeah, they really do. And it's awesome to see ChargePoint actually moving in sympathy with Blink there. I think it's an amazing move. And both of them are starting to really break out of some pretty key levels here. And man, I'd love to see Blink get up above $42. That would be like an amazing upper resistance to break out above. And you can see yesterday in after hours, we actually hit that and then fell back down. So with the way we moved up at open or into open today, I would kind of expect another larger move. Like it would definitely suck to hit this resistance and then pop right back down. So definitely look for a break. I would definitely try to make it break 42 though.
All right, another one we have to talk about is SNDL. It also reported earnings in after hours yesterday. This is a marijuana stock, and they're up like 20% or so. They're up a pretty good amount, and basically their earnings were okay, but they announced a $100 million share repurchase program. So it looks like all the marijuana stocks are kind of popping up off of this trend. You know, SNDL, you could look at Tilray, which is TLRY, and then like, just stocks like that. But Tom, we know how these marijuana stocks are too. Like they're pretty hard to trade, but when they run up, like, you know, they will go crazy.
Yeah, and you can see that SNDL is going to open up like 20% or something crazy like that. This has actually been a pretty big move to the upside. And, you know, it's actually interesting to me how right here at the beginning of pre-market or the end of after hours yesterday, they popped up and hit $1 even just about, or you could say like 99.9 cents and then popped right back down. So $1 even is going to be a nice psychological level up there. And if we're able to break above $1, that could honestly be a pretty good price point. Like to put down as an alert or just an upper resistance level to look for. I think that's going to be an amazing level there. You know, that's just such a big psychological level being $1. And if we're able to break that, hopefully it gets a good move.
Yeah, and like when you look at like a daily or like a weekly chart on this one, we could see that like for the most part, it does fall. But when it does pop up, like it really, really pops up. And in certain ways, it kind of reminds me like the VIX, because like for the most part it falls, but you know when it does pop up, it does go really crazy. Implied volatility is relatively high on this one, with it being over 200%, but it's still like low like compared to like other points it's had throughout its chart history.
Yeah, definitely. And the good thing is it was honestly bouncing right off of that support again, too. Like I know lots of people were talking about buying it on the 60-cent support, and it seemed like a pretty good time to buy it right there. So honestly, like it was moving pretty well on the technicals. And, you know, we're seeing lots of these stocks start to pop back up lately that have been kind of, consolidating down here at those lower levels.
There we go. All right. Well, I just want to welcome everyone to the stream really quickly. Thank you guys so much for being here and happy Friday. Welcome Mike, Jamie, Alex, David, Carlos, Rick, I'm Fierce, Vicky, Gabriel, Kathy, Bill, and Spacely to the stream. We really appreciate you guys. And if you like the stream, it would help us out so much if you could hit that like button. It takes like 2 seconds, but it really, really helped us out. And with the first comment, we have Mike saying, lost a lot of money this week on Palantir. Is this a good time to pick up some more shares? I would say so. They definitely have a ton of growth potential, and their earnings were actually pretty good. So the market just didn't like them, even though it was pretty good earnings overall. Tom, I don't know about you, but when I look at Palantir's like daily chart especially, obviously we've had a lot of consolidation, a lot of back and forth movement, but I feel like Palantir will be one of those setups kind of like Lucid, where it has all this consolidation and then like 1 week it just explodes up, you know? So like for that reason, I think it's just best to like hold long-term shares.
Yeah, I think that would definitely be the better way to go as well. You know, the shares would be awesome here at these levels too, like right around $23. Like we're just below that one support at like 24. You know, we're also getting back to these support levels that we were touching back in July. So I feel like it's a pretty good time to buy it personally. And, you know, I've honestly been eyeing it up pretty hard down here. I know I've been eyeing up Palantir down here. I've been eyeing up Corsair. While they've been pretty low too. And I feel like those two stocks are at pretty good levels right now for the longer term. Like, of course, we've had some stocks like Plug flying up, Lucid, stocks like that. And, you know, it'd be awesome for some of these other ones like Corsair to start to actually get these big breakouts right here. Like, you know, we've been waiting for a long time on some of these plays. Corsair, Palantir, you know, you name it. Some of them have just been lagging behind, and it would just be such a good move for Palantir to get back up there. But man, I'm really waiting because it's been having so much problems breaking out above 2750. Like you said, the earnings were good. The only reason that they fell was because the earnings slowed down a little bit. Like, it doesn't even, you know, their profits were awesome. The revenue was good. So I don't know. I don't really understand why it fell this much, but either way, you know, like you said, it's at support and the earnings really go crazy all the time. So, you know, that's why we don't play them, you know, because we might've been playing Palantir to the upside and then it just turns right around out of nowhere.
Yeah, just good for a long-term hold, in my opinion. It should do fine over the long term. And we have David saying, good morning, let's go and close the week strong. There we go. All right, then we have Rick saying, loving my Blink calls. How's Blink doing, Tom?
Really good. It's actually just now breaking that high of after hours yesterday. Running up, actually broke above $42 there for a second. And man, it's on fire. It's really starting to run right now. If we look at it on the 1 minute, it looks even more exponential. And man, I really love the way it's starting to break $42. I really hope that we get a big breakout right here. Hopefully we don't see a little bit of like a fake out or like a pullback. I would love to see it keep running.
Awesome. All right. We have Alex saying, any levels to watch for QQQ? So NASDAQ, I know there's the market's been back and forth. What levels do you have for us?
Yeah, let's look at the NASDAQ on the daily chart here. It looks like the QQQ, as we start to pull back here over the next couple of days, there's definitely going to be a bigger support down here right around 383. We can see that was definitely a big point of resistance over the past like a couple of weeks or so. Below that, I'm kind of seeing another support around like 370. So, but the main one I'm looking at is right there around 383 to 380. I think that one's going to be a bigger one to look for. And honestly, it looks like to the upside, there's a huge resistance right around that $400 even area, which is awesome to see. And then intraday, there's even some resistance right around, you could say 393. So I feel like looking at it, to me, I have a little bit more of a bias to the downside with it right now, but either way, I feel like it's kind of like at intraday support slash resistance levels. So I feel like it has a good chance to pop either way right now, but we'll just have to see how the overall market goes. Because if we see Tesla, Nvidia, and AMD all start to fall, I would be pretty worried about the QQQ.
All right, there we go. Tom, I don't know if hell froze over or what, but DraftKings is actually popping. I can't believe it.
Wow, look at that. It actually got pretty close to that $40 support, Mike, and it's popping back today. We're up 2.6%. Hopefully we can get back up above these earnings levels. And I'm actually really happy that we didn't break that low on that earnings right there. I think that would have been a pretty bad thing to fall below that. So I'm really glad that $40 ended up holding up, at least for right now. We'll have to see if it holds up for the next few days. But man, if we go back in the past, like especially on like if we go to like May 13th, we actually popped down, touched that $40 support, and then ended up getting a pretty nice uptrend over the next few weeks. So hopefully we start to see that happen here. I know DraftKings is getting beaten down. And the thing that I really like about it is that we can see how we had this big leg to the downside to hit $50. And then we had a second leg down. And usually we start to rise after that second leg. It kind of happened right here, how we had that huge leg and then we had the second one and then we hit that 40 support and we're kind of at the same setup right here. So hopefully it holds up and starts to go back.
Here we go. Well, it's good to finally see some green, finally, right? I mean, like over like the past couple months, it's been brutal. So good day so far.
Yeah, this is awesome actually for us. Man, it's just, it's like you said, it's been brutal the past week or two with DraftKings. Like no matter what, it's just had red day after red day.
Yeah. Alrighty. So we also have some other like growth stocks popping. Palantir is not doing bad, but I was specifically looking at NIO and then RUN. So when you look at NIO, up nearly 3%, it's definitely trending in the right direction. And especially like as all these other EV stocks have already ran up, NIO's been lagging a little bit.
Yeah, it really has. And, you know, its earnings went kind of crazy. We can see it flew down and then it flew right back up the next day it opened and then came right back down. I don't know. You know, I like NIO for the longer term. And I feel like that in the setup it's in right now, I feel like it could honestly start to move out up kind of like a Lucid or like a like an RUN or maybe even Plug. If we go look at those setups, you can see Plug very slowly started to just break out of these key levels. And I feel like NIO is starting to do that right now. If we start to break out above like $45, I'm definitely going to eye this one potentially up towards that $50 to $55 resistance. I think that's going to be some of the better levels to look for on NIO over the next few days. So I don't know. I really think that it's in that type of growth setup right now. And I love the recovery today. If, like I said, if we start to break out above 45, I'll really eye this one up because, man, the way that these growth stocks have been running, you wouldn't want to miss the boat with NIO.
Yeah. I just think the best way with NIO is just buy shares and hold, you know, like I feel like it's really hard to trade like for the short term. Like just look at that 5 minute chart that you're looking at right now. Like it's just all over the place, back and forth. And I just feel like for the short term, at least right now, it's like pretty unpredictable. So I feel like if you just hold shares, you should be fine.
Yeah, I honestly disagree. You know, I kind of feel like that. I feel like we could see this one go up pretty good. You know, we've been seeing stocks like Lucid start to really break out, stocks like Plug, stocks like RUN. They're starting to really break out of some of these levels and start to get some nice movement. And I feel like the NIO is honestly in that same type of setup. Like, of course, you know, we saw NIO go crazy, or, you know, Plug, I mean, go crazy for a couple of days here before we started breaking out. Same thing that happened last time. And, you know, I feel like NIO is just, it's in that consolidation phase now, but once we get above that key resistance right here around like 44 to 44.50, I feel like it'll start moving like Plug or like RUN.
Well, I agree in that sense, but I'm saying, I think where we disagree is I think the best way to play NIO right now is shares rather than these short-term options because, you know, over the past couple weeks, it's been pretty back and forth. So for that reason, I just think it would be better for most people to probably just buy shares and hold them rather than trying to time these short-term uptrends and downtrends.
Yeah, definitely. Because if you don't get in at the right time, I mean, it's going to be rough. You know, like if you don't get in at the correct time of the breakout, it's going to be bad. You know, you might buy a little late and then get caught, you know, buying at the top and then it ends up falling on you. And then you're stuck with the options going against you. So I definitely see what you're saying there. But, you know, for all the scalpers out there, definitely add it on the radar. You know, if it starts to break out, you know, it could be a pretty good breakout trade. But like Mike said, I'd rather buy and hold shares anyways. That's kind of my forte. You know, my favorite thing to do in the market is almost buy and hold shares.
Right. So Boeing's looking pretty good. It's just one of those slow but steady movers, you can say. I know it has been struggling a good amount over the past year, but I feel like it's at a pretty good level right now, just above 220. It's a solid company. Should be great for the long term. And I like how it's still at a good level. So it's also moving up. And when it gets into like certain setups, like sometimes it has that like explosive potential too.
It really does. And I love the way it's starting to break out. And I'll tell you what, this consolidation looks pretty solid right here. And, you know, we're actually confirming off of some of these trend lines, like this red trend line here. This has been going on ever since March 15th. We've been stuck below that. And it's actually nice to see it starting to break out. And with the way the green line starting to come in, Mike, I'll be honest, this one looks like a pretty nice bullish setup as well. You know, we've seen lots of stocks consolidating a lot lately and some starting to break. So hopefully Boeing is one of those stocks that's going to start to break out. And the technicals are honestly lining up so well. I loved how we bounced off that 210 support last time. I know we were really eyeing that up, Mike, around like that 208 to 210 area whenever it was there back around like the end of October. So I really like it now that it's breaking out. And I feel like for the next couple of weeks, this one could be a pretty good swing play. Even if you just wanted to get shares and start for like a long-term play, I feel like it might start, if it breaks out above 230, we might see a pretty good run up, maybe up to that 240 resistance again, or possibly hopefully higher, but I would think at least up to 240 if we break 230.
Yeah, I like it. I think it's a pretty solid setup and it's relatively safe. Like if you get shares too, like let's say you grab some shares and worst case scenario, it starts to sell off. Like if you wanted to, you could probably just hold it for the long term. So
yeah, and it won't be a bad loss. Like if it sells off down to like 200 or even slightly lower, like that 190 support, It's not even going to be that bad of a loss compared to where you bought in.
Yeah. Especially when you're looking at some of these growth stocks, right? Yeah. Oh, gosh. All right. Yeah. So good stuff. And then we have Johnny Leverage saying, is it a good time to buy Lucid shares at these levels? I feel Lucid is not going to stop and I don't want to lose the upside. Well, if you feel like it's not going to stop, then yeah, like your best bet would just be to grab shares. But keep in mind, this stock is one of the most volatile stocks on the market right now, arguably. And then it also has earnings. What is that? It has earnings on, the 15th after close. So it's like no one can predict what's going to happen in the short term with this one. Like I said, arguably one of the most volatile stocks on the market, plus earnings, plus just a crazy earnings season we've had. So like no one knows what's going to happen in the short term with this one. But if you like it for the long term, your best bet would be to just start to average into shares. So maybe you know you want to invest $2,000 into this one. Maybe you buy like $600 worth of it today and then $600 before earnings and then, you know, the rest after earnings. I don't know. You know, it's just the short term will be very volatile.
Yeah, good example. And I feel like that looking at it, you know, there's going to be a little bit of resistance at $50. I feel like it's in that type of bullish setup right now. But, you know, the thing that sucks about it is it's kind of already broken out quite a bit. Like we're looking at lots of stocks right now, like Corsair down here at support, even NIO, you know, kind of starting to break out maybe. But, you know, we see Lucid, though, and it's already been on a huge uptrend. It's had some awesome news. You know, I know everyone, you know, it's always a lot of people are going to get FOMO with Lucid, you know, fear of missing out. I know that that's going to be a big problem with this one because people have seen exactly what Tesla can do. But keep in mind that they're no Tesla yet. So looking at it, I would say be careful. They might post lower highs on the daily chart. You know, we never know. But looking at it, I think the setup's decent. Like Mike said, I would start to average in if you really, really, really like them. I definitely wouldn't go all in. I would definitely use the ratios like Mike said. Maybe get 25% or 20% of your total position. I think that would be a good way to go right now. But the one thing is there is earnings coming up. So keep in mind if they report like some bad numbers or maybe like a bad outlook for the next quarter, they could end up tanking down a little bit. And, you know, they just started delivering vehicles. So who knows how those numbers are going to be.
No doubt. All right, there we go. We have Iranical saying, good morning, thoughts about Ride. So I do not like this one. If you believe in the company and you want to take a shot with it, go for it. Trust your gut. Shares would probably be the best way to go. But this one, out of all the EV stocks out there, this one's just like, they're not doing too good. I believe they have $0 in revenue from when I last checked. I could have swore I read something this morning saying that they have $0 in revenue. Their chart's been brutal. I just feel like there's so many other better opportunities with the EV sector right now. So for that reason, I would never touch them.
Yeah, I wouldn't either. And Mike, whenever you just said that, you were like, for that reason, I would never touch them. You reminded me of Shark Tank. You're like, for that reason, I'm out. it sounded perfectly like that. Oh, but God. Yeah, Lordstown has definitely had some issues, at least with their chart over the past couple of years. I know people are definitely bullish on them since they're another EV company. It looks like that $5 support's pretty good. So I think if you like them and you have to get shares, I think it would be good. But I'm definitely with Mike. I think some of the other ones are definitely setting up better. And I feel like, for example, we're seeing like Lucid right now starting to pop. I'm not talking about getting them right now specifically, but there is lots of good setups. You know, I feel like I keep going back to the same two, but Corsair's in a good spot. You know, there's even lots of these stocks like FSLY kind of down here by support. So I feel like some of these other stocks, you could just have some better, maybe some better exposure, maybe not to the EV sector, but at least to the growth stocks.
Yeah, for sure. All right. So then we have David saying the donkey horse. Will it recover soon? And I don't know. I hope it does, but it's been looking brutal. Ever since they had that news with like the SEC investigating them or whatever that news was, I think it was on like September 1st, I just stopped following them. I had some calls on them. I just closed it and took the loss on it. I'm glad I did too because it was, it's just looking rough. And it one needs a catalyst. And then plus when you have like an open SEC investigation, that's never good.
Yeah, that actually is a pretty bad news there. So definitely look at that. Anything with the SEC is always bad. You know, we see we've seen some companies just have huge downtrends because of that. Especially like these companies like Workhorse. What was the one, Mike, that, oh, NKLA, was it, that had the fraud going on? Like, actually, like, low-key, NKLA has been bouncing off of this $10 support. Like, man, they're honestly kind of on the uptrend here. I mean, I'm definitely not saying to buy them. I would never buy them, but it's definitely moving pretty interesting right now, to say the least. But going back to Workhorse, it's definitely interesting. I feel like it's at support. Again, though, it's not my favorite. It's kind of like Lordstown. Like, you know, I like them a little bit better than Ride, but in the end, I feel like they're similar to Ride to me. I like Lucid and some of these other companies a little bit better. And like, if Lucid could just dip down and maybe create some good opportunities, I feel like that would be a better way to go.
Yeah, I agree. And like, if you're just like looking at stocks like that are at low levels, I just want to point out that there's actually a lot of stocks at some really low levels right now. I know that the market itself is basically at all-time highs, but like, if you look at stocks like Tom mentioned, like Corsair, you know, that's at one of the lowest levels it's ever been. They have a ton of growth potential, and like, they're a solid company, you know. It's like I would just rather be buying the dip on a stock like Corsair rather than like, you know, Donkey Horse or Ride or anything like that. Like, if you want to take a shot with Donkey Horse or Ride, by all means, go for it. But there's actually a lot of stocks at some really good levels right now.
Yeah, there is. And even DraftKings, like, you're right around that $40 support. And, you know, it might go a little bit lower, but for the longer term, acquiring shares here is going to be an awesome time to do that. You know, Baba's still fairly low given what we're seeing. They are kind of turning over today, but, you know, they're at a pretty good lower level. Another one, Mike, is actually Palantir that they've been falling down a lot this week. It's been pretty bad. I know we covered them a lot at the beginning of the show, but man, it's definitely rough right now in the growth sector. You know, we're seeing some of the stocks like Plug and RUN run, like some of those stocks that are getting that funding in the infrastructure bill, but it seems like most of them are still down here at the good levels, like you mentioned, like Corsair. And you know, it's hard to trade the market because you have to pick the stocks that obviously are going to go up, but everybody has their own, I will say, like, sentimental feelings. And I feel like that a lot of times that might cloud your judgment. You know, like, if you're looking at these, some of these stocks like Lucid right now, and they're flying up, you know, obviously you don't want to miss the boat, but at the same time, you're buying into such a high level. Whereas Corsair, if you can look at it more objectively, you're buying down here on support, you're buying at a good level, you're buying right before the holiday season comes up where they'll probably get more sales than usual. And it's just, you know, you just have to look at it more objectively rather than, I know a lot of traders look at it where they just see stocks that they like they'll see like Workhorse and then they like it. So then they'll just only stick with Workhorse, but, you know, just expand your horizons and just start to look at different things. I think it'll help a lot.
Yeah, I would say everyone has definitely some biases in the market. And I would say a big thing is being objective, whether you're, you know, looking at long-term plays, or you're just looking at a play that you already own that's struggling. So it's definitely really important to be objective. So there we go. And then we have Sean saying Donkey Horse wants to be a penny stock. It looks like it. Like, I was looking at some of the news for it, and I was just like shaking my head. Like, I don't know. Like, I hope it pops up for anyone who's in it, but it's just looking rough. And like, that chart, like, they were looking so good like last year, and then talk about a complete reversal. It's just, yeah, it's tough.
Yeah, it really is. And I was expecting them to do pretty good, especially whenever they were moving like last year, like the way they were. I was really expecting some good stuff out of Workhorse, but man, that bad news lately has just been terrible for them. The IV is going nuts though, Mike. Like, that IV went crazy for a while, up to 213%, and then flew like right back down, man. Like, that's a crazy IV pop and then drop, actually.
Yep. All right. So we have Kathy saying, do you think Dal will fall more? So DAL, I would say so, but not like a crazy amount, like maybe down to like 42.50 or something like that. If we're lucky, maybe 42. I'm not expecting like a huge tank with airlines, at least right now, as of like the next week or so. But it's definitely downtrending in a pretty strong way. And, you know, that the whole like airline industry has definitely been struggling like over the past week or so. So I would say probably.
Yeah, probably so. I would say as well. It's not looking good. It's starting to sell off. we hit that resistance here at like 45.60, which is not a good sign. And, you know, there is a bit of a gap here on the daily chart to fill. And, you know, it looks like we're starting to fill it. So, you know, maybe we could get down to 42, like you said. I feel like that would be a pretty good support if we did.
Awesome. All right, we have Johnny saying, FSR is kind of a hidden EV gem, maybe. They are having the Ocean SUV global debut at the LA Auto Show on November 17th, 2021. I have not been following this one, so I don't really know too much about it. So I don't really have too much input with it, but the chart has been decent. Lots of upwards and downwards movement. Like I said, I just don't really follow it too much, so I don't have too much to say with it.
Yeah, and I don't follow them too much either, at least fundamentally, but I have heard a lot about Fisker over the past couple of years. And, you know, I know that their chart has been all over the place, but I feel like it's moving a lot better than some of these other charts. Like whenever we see Workhorse down around lows and, you know, some of those other EV stocks that aren't moving too good, I feel like at least Fisker's chart has been moving pretty decently. And at least ever since like this May, we've been recovering up. So it looks decent right now. It actually had a lot of momentum yesterday, which was nice to see. But in the end, I don't follow them too much. And I feel like it could be decent just looking at the chart, but I'll definitely have to look into the fundamentals on this one a little bit more. And with the way they're moving, honestly, they might be kind of like a Lucid, you know, they might be a little bit better than some of those, you know, Nikolas or like Workhorses.
All right. Let's see. I'm just doing a quick scan to see if we have any like crazy movement so far. Looks like Facebook's having a pretty good reversal, or I should say Meta, not Facebook. Meta's having a good reversal. Let's see. I'm trying to see what else is moving. Lucid is tanking off a little bit. So yeah, no crazy setups as of this second. We have Rome saying, good morning, guys. PayPal right at support. Let's take a look. PYPL. Wow, this is actually pretty good. I'm actually really glad you brought this one up. I might sell some puts on it.
Yeah, it's actually right at that $200 level. And, you know, with the way we just had that big gap down, I would not be surprised if we ended up falling down through this one too. But either way, I feel like it would be good to sell some puts, maybe start to average in just in case it starts to pop. I feel like that for the longer term, PayPal will be pretty good. I don't know. I know the earnings sucked right here that made them drop now, but you know, they've been having some pretty bad downwards movement for the past couple of months, along with stocks like MasterCard and Visa. And those two stocks have been recovering up a little bit, but PayPal has just continued to die off. It's just, man, that earnings report really sucked for them, but I'm definitely bullish on them for the long term, Mike. It's just in the short term, I don't know how much more they're going to keep going.
Yep. All right. We have Bravo saying, good morning, guys. Is Disney a good pickup? Just like I did with MSGS, slow average buy. I would say so. Their earnings were disappointing, no doubt about that. But they are a solid company. You know, they're not going anywhere. They do have like a lot of growth potential at the same time. I know they're making a couple new movies as well. So that could be good with like boosting their Disney Plus subscribers, because I know that's a huge thing that analysts look at. So I really like them. I know a lot of smart money has been averaging into some, or has been getting into some long-term calls on it. So I really like Disney. It's, I like it.
Yeah, I like it too, especially just to average in. You know, we're seeing PayPal fall off, and I feel like Disney's in a similar setup. You know, it's just starting to fall off and start to move to the downside. And I feel like it's going to be good to average in as it does this, you know, because, you know, it's always good to buy in, like, obviously lower than it is higher, in my opinion. And whenever you're looking at these better stocks like Disney, especially with Disney Plus and stuff like that, you know, all that they need is like one good show to come out. I know that they have a new Buzz Lightyear movie coming out this over the next year. That's supposed to be pretty big. You know, it's like a Toy Story movie. So hopefully that gets them some good numbers. You know, like if that's a Disney Plus exclusive or something like that, I wouldn't be surprised if tons of people started signing up again. So definitely eye it up. You know, we're seeing Netflix start to move with that Squid Game show. And I feel like Disney definitely can start to move as well. And maybe Squid Game has been affecting Disney in a negative way, you know, maybe taking away some customers and stuff like that. But, you know, I feel like Disney, like I said, they just need one good piece of news to come back up. And if you're just averaging the shares slowly as they drop, you know, even if they go down to like, let's say 145 or something, your average then might be around like 150, which would be an amazing longer term level to be at.
Exactly. And, you know, it is a solid company, and I think they'll be, I think they'll do great over the long term. And then Bravo also said that he's buying shares of Disney and DraftKings. So looks like you're picking up these dips, Bravo. I love to see it. You know, DraftKings is at an awesome level. I love it and hate it how it goes in these like crazy trends. Like it'll go on an uptrend, like it'll be up like every day for like a month straight, and then it'll do the same thing to the downside. So its trends are crazy on it, but they have a ton of long-term growth potential, and I'm very excited to see how they do.
Yeah, and you know, I actually just thought of another scenario with DraftKings is that over the winter, you know, more people are going to be inside, like maybe watching these sports and stuff like that. So it might just generate some more betting revenue for them. I know that they did a lot better last year, like when they IPO'd in the wintertime. So that's a good sign. And, you know, hopefully all these sports going on really help DraftKings because, man, they're right around support. And I'm glad to see you buying the dip too. I think that's really smart to do. I've been buying the dip here on a couple of these stocks. And, you know, DraftKings is one of the ones I've been buying too.
And they just got approved for that New York sports betting license. You know, that's huge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's another good sign. And, you know, that's New York, and more states are supposed to start doing stuff like that over the next couple of years. And that's going to be awesome. You know, I know that there's supposed to be some good voting stuff in different states, not all of them. But, you know, I know that a few states are looking to legalize this stuff, and it should bring DraftKings a lot more customers as well.
Yeah, and like New York is New York, you know, like that's a big state to be in. So I don't know. I'm happy with how they're doing. It's just their stock has been brutal lately, and it kind of sucks to see. But they'll be fine for the long term, in my opinion. And then let's see. And then Bravo said that he kept averaging into MSGS until it reached $155. His average was $162, and look at the stock now. There we go.
I actually remember him talking about this as he was getting in. You know, I remember this was like right whenever we started streaming, I think, Mike. He was talking about Madison Square Garden getting in. I think he kept talking about the Knicks playing there again, didn't he?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, and then it looks like they're actually doing pretty good. So, yeah, awesome pickup there. There is some resistance around $200, which, you know, seems to be holding up pretty strong for now. But I'll be honest, I wouldn't be surprised if on the daily chart we started to maybe fill this gap a little bit more. I wouldn't be surprised to maybe hit 220 over the next like year or so. I think it could, I think Madison Square Garden has a good chance to keep going back up, especially as COVID starts to reopen more. And the good news is at least they allow people in who have the vaccination. So hopefully they're getting some type of revenue.
Right. So then we have Ravi saying GDX, please. So I really like GDX. I like GLD, SLV. I think they look pretty awesome right now. I know the inflation levels were pretty crazy, the CPI data that was reported on Wednesday, I believe. And that really helped like kickstart gold and silver. So I really like it. I think it'll do pretty dang good over like the next couple months and the next couple years. And I like it.
Yeah, and what did inflation have? Like one of the largest moves in 30 years, I think it said.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. Yep, 30 years.
Yeah, it actually blew my mind. I was like, man, this is like worse than like 2007, 2008. Like, man, like I know the inflation back then was going crazy as well. And man, it's crazy to know that, you know, we're even getting higher than that. We're getting higher than, you know, the dot-com bubble inflation. And man, I know the inflation during like the 70s and 80s was getting pretty rough. So I know that we're getting up to those types of levels, but yeah, I mean, definitely GDX looks pretty good. I feel like that gold and silver should be good as inflation starts to go up. And I'll be honest, I love the way gold's breaking out of some of these technicals right now. It looks kind of like honestly, Boeing is almost in like the same type of technical setup as gold. But looking at it, I love the setup, and I'm so glad to see it starting to break. I think GLD will be up around like 180 maybe over the next few months. And I feel like it can maybe go even higher than that if the inflation keeps going. But we'll have to see how the numbers go. And, you know, the Fed might try to, you know, curb it a little bit.
Yep, no doubt about that. But either way, like, and like another thing too is like, even if like, let's say you got like GLD shares or SLV shares, or you bought physical gold and silver, or you got GDX or whatever, like just over the long term, it should increase anyways. You know what I mean? It's like, even if you like just buy the shares outright and let's say it goes down in the short term, like if you hold it for the long term, you should be fine anyways.
Yeah. And the thing is like gold and silver, like if we go back, like if we go to a gold futures chart, cause this will give you the best true outlook, I guess. If you go back and we go to the max weekly, like you can see that gold has performed pretty well historically. And it looks like we're actually almost in like a nice bullish flag type of setup right now with an awesome support at like 1680. and an awesome resistance level up around like 2000. So definitely eye it up. I feel like we're definitely on the uptrend here. The technicals are looking pretty good. And with inflation and stuff going crazy, I feel like gold and silver are some of the better places to put your money. You know, lots of investors are talking about also grabbing some Bitcoin and stuff. And, you know, Bitcoin's been kind of following gold over the past week or so.
Yeah. Big, we know how Bitcoin is. That's a powerhouse.
Yeah. And, you know, people are talking about potentially using Bitcoin as another way to hedge the markets. And, you know, it seems like a pretty decent way to do it. You know, I've only been eyeing that up for about a year or so, but it seems like it's a pretty good hedge so far. You know, sometimes it goes down with the market, but in the end, it's always a good time to buy it, I feel like.
Yeah, at least right now. All right, so then we have Bravo saying, I'm curious what's up with weed stocks like CGC, MSOS, MJ, etc. So there are two main reasons I'm seeing. The first one being news came out saying an Ohio Senate bill would allow medical marijuana for any patient who can reasonably be expected to benefit. So that's number one. And then number two, SNDL reported earnings. And the earnings were okay, but I don't know, nothing crazy. But with SNDL, they announced a $100 million share repurchase program. So those are the two main catalysts.
Yeah, and this is actually a pretty interesting stock, Mike, being MSOS. It's actually a U.S. like marijuana company ETF. And I'm trying to like look up their holdings right now on MarketWatch here and just to see like what they have. And man, these are actually some pretty interesting companies. I'll have to look into these because these are supposed to be more of like, you know, U.S. type of companies. So very interesting. And it's very weird to see how MSOS has been really selling off. And hopefully these U.S. companies start to pop. It looks like that New York legalization news started really making MSOS start to move to the upside. I feel like this could be a pretty good ETF, actually. I need to eye up the companies in there a little bit more, but man, it looks pretty good. You know, the main marijuana stocks people talk about right now are all Canadian stocks like CGC, Tilray. I think Cronos. No, I think Cronos might be in the U.S., but either way, I feel like most of them are Canadian. I know CGC and Tilray are for sure. And whenever you look at those types of stocks, they haven't been moving too well. But I will say MSOS has been recovering pretty well with that New York news. And, you know, it's interesting to see these U.S. companies. I'll have to look into them a little bit more. I know that Grow Generation, GRWG, I've definitely heard about that one quite a bit.
Yeah, same. All right, there we go. So just know that there's basically moving off of sympathy with SNDL. At the same time, had some relatively good news out of Ohio. So that's good to see. And these MJ stocks, they go crazy like a couple times a year, and it's fun to catch them if you can, but you know, they just move so quickly. So either way, keep them on your radar. Then we have Ironical saying, I'm using Webull and this platform does not allow to do poor man's covered call. I'm wondering if it's possible on Thinkorswim. So you should be able to do the poor man's covered call on Webull. I don't see why you wouldn't be able to. One thought is if you, let's say you have a call and you want to do the poor man's covered call on it. One, you have to have spread trading enabled. So if you don't have spread trading enabled, that's why it will not be allowed. And two, that call will be used as collateral. So you cannot have like a pending sell order for that call. So to answer your question, yes, you can do the poor man's covered call on Thinkorswim. You could do it on Robinhood, and I don't see why you wouldn't be able to do it on Webull. So just make sure you don't have a sell order in place and make sure you have spreads enabled. Just trying to see what the next comment. We have Queen saying, do you guys think SNDL is a potential squeeze play again? Yes, but it's hard to trade these MJ stocks. They just explode like a couple times each year, and there's a lot of fake outs along the way. So there's definitely potential for it. Tom, what do you think with like this SNDL action?
Yeah, I think SNDL is just moving crazy today. I mean, the thing that I don't like about SNDL right now is that they hit that $1 mark and then started to fall. I feel like that's going to be such a hard resistance level to move back above, but I really like the stock. And I feel like if the marijuana sector starts to pop off, SNDL will definitely follow along with it. You know, it's a pretty hyped up stock, and you know, the main ones should end up going up like Tilray, CGC, SNDL. Even if like the US has good news, it should end up bringing some good sympathy into these other stocks. And you know, I like it. It's just for today. I don't think I would play it personally. It looks like a pretty bad drop right now. And I don't like the way how it hit that $1 mark right on the, like, pretty much dead even. That just, it didn't sit right with me. And I just, I know that's going to be hard to break out right there. But if it breaks $1, I might look for like a quick momentum play. But, you know, in the end, kind of like what we talked about earlier, that's not going to be realistic for most people.
Yeah. Like, it's just hard to play these MJ stocks. Like, I love to trade them when they're exploding up. It's just like there's so many fake outs along the way. So definitely keep it on your radar. And like, I guess if you wanted to, it doesn't hurt to get like a very small like starter position. And then you could always add or take away from it depending on how it moves. But just keep that in mind.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, it's always good to buy them down there by supports. Like, you know, we were talking about it for a long time down there being by support. Same thing with some of the other stocks. Like we have CRSR down here by support. So, you know, sometimes, you know, you just kind of miss the boat. I know now that it's starting to pop, everybody wants to get in, of course, but I would just be careful with it. You know, it had a huge pop up today. I would almost say let it go for a day or two and see what it does. And then maybe you can get in slightly lower, but in the end, I would just maybe throw an alert above $1 just in case it pops. And then that way you can just get in maybe, maybe up there or something. But in the end, I feel like some of the other marijuana stocks might be a little bit better personally. Like personally, I think Tilray might be slightly better. I know that they're still risky, but you know, just looking at it, Mike, like what are some of your favorite marijuana stocks? I know that it's hard to pick them because, you know, they're really crazy lately and a lot of them aren't even in the United States, but you know, like what are some of your favorites?
I really don't have like a favorite long-term one just yet. I'm waiting for like a solid, like my problem with them is most of these MJ stocks, they're not good fundamentally. So I don't really have like a favorite, but like in terms of trading, I would say Tilray. Normally their options are pretty liquid. Like we could see today, like on next week's expiration, we already have, what is that, over 20,000 contracts traded just today. The market hasn't even been open for an hour, and then, you know what I mean? So I really like Tilray. It's pretty liquid. It normally has some great moves. Options are normally priced pretty well. So yeah, I would definitely say Tilray.
Yeah, I would say so too. I mean, I like that one. It's my favorite one as far as the Canadian stocks go, and it definitely has some good movement. So I love them. They're always on my watch list, of course. One of the ones I've been eyeing up a lot lately that, you know, I've been talking about is PLNHF, which is Planet 13. I know this one's like in Nevada or down in Las Vegas, and they have another location opened up in California now as well. And they're actually right on this $4 support that they were hitting a long time ago. So I feel like this one's pretty good, and it is in the United States, which is nice, but I'm really going to be eyeing up this MSOS ETF, Mike. This is pretty interesting, and it says it's a U.S. cannabis ETF, and I'm definitely going to eye up those companies in there. I think this one's actually going to be pretty interesting for the next year or two.
There we go. All right, so then we have Billy saying, any thoughts on FUBO, F-U-B-O? So it got destroyed on earnings the other day. It's not bad. I wouldn't mind holding shares of it for the long term. It's definitely not my favorite setup in the world, but like if I was looking for a play that's like kind of like a long shot for like the next couple of years, I would definitely consider this one.
Yeah, me too. You know, it's a sports streaming stock. It's had a lot of growth. There has been a lot of rejections at resistance, but I feel like it could have a pretty nice pop. You know, it's definitely going to be a tough one to play, but in the end, I feel like FUBO has a pretty good shot to go up. They've been talking about getting into like the sports betting sector and stuff like that too. And that could be awesome. Like if somehow they're able to get like, I've heard of like live stream betting, like where like you're watching the game and you're able to like bet like with your remote and stuff, like just clicking on it and stuff. That would be awesome if they ended up implementing stuff like that. And honestly, with the way sports betting and stuff is going, I wouldn't be surprised to see that in the future, but hopefully FUBO starts to go up. I feel like it's almost reminds me of like a Palantir right here, Mike. It just had a bad earnings and a bad downtrend, but I feel like grabbing shares would be a pretty good way to go.
Yep, I'm with you. All right, so we have Ravi saying, what time frames should we look at for day trading on any stock? So I like to use like the 5 minute, and I also like to use the 1 minute, but I would say there are so many other factors that go into like day trading other than the like the chart time frame you're looking at. Like there's just so many other things. Like I don't think like if you use like a 3 minute chart or like a 30 minute chart that's going to make that'll make or break you. I just feel like there's so many other variables that come into place.
Yeah, I think so too. And I actually really like I like to use the 5 and the 1 minute personally as well. But I'm with you, Mike. There's definitely so much other stuff that matters like way more. Like, I'll just name a couple, like support and resistance, obviously. The headlines that day, the overall market, like if we see the SPY selling off really drastically, it's hard for a lot of these stocks to move up, especially the ones like more of in the S&P 500. But in the end, if the overall market's tanking, it can end up impacting the whole market, of course. So there's lots of different factors. I always get that question though, Mike. I don't know about you, but I feel like I get that question way too often about the time frame. And in the end, the time frame doesn't really make a big difference. Like obviously, like if you're looking at it on a 5 minute and you're trying to scalp, maybe the 1 minute would be better if you're doing super quick like scalping trades. If you're doing more of like longer term swing plays, then like the max daily chart's probably going to be better for you. But in the end, I just use a big mixture of them all. Like I use the daily, I use the 1 minute, the 5 minute, the 15 minute. Sometimes I'm even looking at the 1 hour and the 4 hour. And it doesn't mean I'm always, looking at like the 1 hour and 4 hour charts just to like look at them strategically. Sometimes I just do it just to see the movement during a certain time or something like that, because there's so many different time frames. And if you're looking at like a like let's just say a 5 day 15 minute, that like for example the time is going to look a lot different than it looks on the 15 minute than it looks on the hour. And if you look at the hour, you can go back 180 days and see it all on one chart. So it's I feel like I get that question way too much, Mike. And in the end, it doesn't really matter too much, like the time frame. It matters more of like your strategy, the headlines and just everything going on in the market.
Yeah, I would strongly argue that your risk management strategies are
Oh, yeah.
much, much more important than what time frame you're using. So, good question overall. Just know that there's a lot more that goes into it. And then we have Max saying, "Wow, what's going on with Bank of America?" So BAC. Let's take a look. BAC down 1%. I'm not seeing any news today with it. Looks just like some normal price action. Let me just look across a couple other bank stocks. Yeah, there's no major news today. It looks like they're just breaking down a little bit.
Yeah, they really are. They're breaking down a little bit. It looks like they might be selling off here. It's not a good sign right now, but the banks have been running up quite a bit lately, I will say. And the last time Powell spoke, the banks started really running to the upside, and now he spoke and the banks are kind of moving down a little bit. And I don't know, like maybe we could just expect Bank of America to fall off a little bit. To me, on the daily, it looks like it posted some lower highs, and it looks like it's in a bearish setup to me. Like we might end up going down for the next few days or so, but definitely eye it up. It's going to be tough, and I feel like the banks move a lot off of the news, and I feel like this inflation data did not help the banks at all. But they ended up rising yesterday, which was good at least.
Yep. All right. It looks like Triple M is exploding up, Tom. They don't have any major news that I'm seeing right now, but up 3%. They have a dividend relatively soon, but they're looking pretty good right now.
Wow, yeah, look at this stock. I know I was in them way back here at like $154. I ended up getting out after it recovered back to like 170. But man, what a crazy move here with Triple M. And this is definitely a slow and steady mover. I actually really like this stock for the longer term. And for the short term, it is kind of at resistance right now. But for the long term, they pay a pretty good dividend. And I know that they're like one of those dividend aristocrats, which means like they've increased their dividend, I think it is, for like 20 or 25 years straight. So that's pretty awesome to see there. I think they're actually at like the 30 or 40 year mark. But either way, I like Triple M for the long term. And in the short term, I feel like it can be all over the place for options. It kind of is a slower mover. You can see it consolidates for a while. So I feel like for options, it's going to be tough to play. But man, for shares, I feel like you almost can't go wrong with this company. Like they're pretty big innovators, and they even make like COVID masks and stuff like that. And like whenever COVID was going on, I know they were kind of like using their factories to try to make different COVID products and stuff like that. And I know that they make a lot of stuff, and they probably won't go anywhere. So I feel like they're nice and safe, which is good.
Yep. All right, I'm just trying to see some of like the good plays we have today. It looks like Airbnb is trending up in a good way. They're looking pretty good. I'm trying to see what else is moving really quickly. Looks like General Motors is still trending in a strong direction. But yeah, I mean, those are the main ones. Tom, do you have like any top stocks or like any favorite setups right now?
Wow, actually, I didn't have General Motors on my watch list, but man, this is actually a really nice move up with them. And this is actually a pretty nice breakout, actually, like right here at $62. If we look at the 90-day 15-minute, this one's starting to really get a nice run up. And like looking at it on the Max Daily, I know we've been talking about this one. I think we talked about it in the video last night, but man, it's getting up there. And I'm really hoping we can start to break out above like 64.30, maybe 64.50 up there at the top. That would be awesome. We've seen Ford start to break out a lot lately, and looks like General Motors might start to make their highs now, and that would be just an amazing run for them. Besides General Motors, another stock that's been on my radar today has actually been MU. Man, these chip stocks have been on fire lately, and MU is actually coming back from the dead. You know, honestly, like people were really downplaying MU whenever they were at that $70 support for a while, and man, it is starting to really grow back up. It's at $76, and with the way AMD, NVIDIA, and a few of these other stocks have been, I won't be surprised if MU comes up and retests $80 or even breaks above it over the next couple of months. But man, what a nice reversal here for them. Like, man, we saw AMD and NVIDIA really outpacing some of these stocks like MU and Qualcomm. And now Qualcomm and MU are actually starting to go up, which is pretty nice to see.
Awesome. All right, we have Bravo saying, how do you guys like V moving forward the next 2 years? So Visa looks pretty good. You know, they're a solid company. I do like them.
Yeah, I like them too. You know, they are on the downtrend though, which is not a good sign. Like to me, it looks pretty bad technically, unfortunately. I feel like we might start to fall down again in the short term. There's definitely support around 207. If we break that, I up 200. I think that'll be a huge psychological and just awesome like wall at $200. Like it's just such a big psychological level. Kind of like what we saw with this morning with, I can't remember the exact stock, but it was a penny stock hit $1 even. Like these psychological SNDL levels are usually pretty big. Yeah, SNDL, you said?
Yes.
Yeah, Sundial hitting $1 even. So yeah, those levels are pretty key, and $200 should be a pretty key one as well. So definitely eye that one up with Visa. We might not even get there because there is another support around 206. So hopefully that one holds up.
There we go. Well, thank you guys so much for watching today's stream. You know, we have some nice movement to start the day. You know, BLNK still looking strong. The market itself is holding up, which is good to see. So yeah, thank you guys so much for joining. We hope you have an amazing weekend, and let's end the trading week strong.